So I always see people wearing those shirts that have a spiral galaxy on them and then a pin drop that says, "You are here," to mark where we think the location of the sun is in our own galaxy, the Milky Way, of hundreds of billions of stars. The question is, though, like, how do we actually know that that's what the shape of the Milky Way is and where the sun is in it? Because we're trapped inside it. There's no way that we can get out of the Milky Way to take an image of it, because that's billions of trillions of kilometers that you would have to travel. It'd be like me plonking you in the middle of a forest and saying, map the positions of the trees in this forest. Oh, but you can't actually move to do it. How we see the Milky Way in the sky is just this band of sort of whitish, diffused light along with all the rest of the stars. So how do we even know that the Milky Way is a spiral galaxy? So all the way back to the 5th century BC, Greek, Arabian, Persian philosophers all consider the nature of the Milky Way, that diffuse band of white across the sky. And a lot of them did suggest it could be made of many, many stars that were much further away from us than the other ones, because it didn't move relative to those. It was clearly in the background. And it wasn't actually until 1610 that Galileo Galilei, of dropping stuff off the Leaning Tower of Pisa fame, actually proved that this was true. He took a telescope to the Milky Way and showed that it was actually made of many faint stars, the light of which all combined to make that diffuse light across the sky. Fast forward now to 1755, and Thomas Wright and Immanuel Kant, i.e. the very famous philosopher.
You just casually cited Immanuel Kant.
Both speculated that because you saw that diffuse band of stars in a strip across the sky, that the structure of the Milky Way was kind of like the structure of the solar system, where you had the sun in the center and the planets going round it. But instead here with the Milky Way, you just had a lot of stars all going around the central object, and that those stars were all rotating. And that was pure speculation then. They had no proof for that. They were basically philosophizing over it. But Kant also took one step further and actually said that the other fuzzy things that we see in the sky that people called nebula, they could also be island universes, as he dubbed them, all of these systems of rotating stars. Then by 1785, William and Caroline Herschel are the first people to try and actually map the Milky Way. And they did that by marking the positions of stars along various different lines of sight when they looked out into space. Now, to do that, they assumed that all the stars are the same brightness. So from their apparent brightness, you could tell how distant they were, which is not a very good assumption we know now. They also were very limited by their telescopes. You know, back then they weren't great. And they also didn't understand that dust in space can actually absorb light from behind it. So if you look in a direction where there is lots of dust, then you're not going to see the many, many stars that are actually hidden behind that dust. So what they ended up with was a map where the sun was pretty much in the center and a very flat structure like what was seen in the sky. Into the 19th century, though, telescopes have got much, much better with the Industrial Revolution, so much so that by 1845, Lord Rosse was actually able to resolve the shapes of those fuzzy nebula things in the sky and found that they had spiral structure. He even managed to show that in some of them, you could resolve individual points of light as if they were stars themselves, giving more weight to Kant's original ideas that these nebula were actually galaxies in their own right, or these island universes, as he called them. So this brings us up to the start of the 20th century, and this is where things start to all kick off. So in 1904, a Dutch astronomer called Kapteyn found that half of the stars in the sky were moving in one direction, and the other half of the stars in the sky were moving in another direction. Now, that was not understood at the time at all, but eventually people made the connection between those results and the ideas of Wright and Kant back in the 18th century, that the Milky Way was a structure like the solar system, but instead of planets going around the center, it was stars rotating around some center. So in 1912, Henrietta Leavitt was studying a type of star in her own Milky Way that we now call Cepheid variable stars. And these stars pulse in their brightness. And what she noticed was that how fast they pulse is directly related to how bright they are. So if you can measure how bright they appear in the sky, you then know how distant they are. And so this meant that we could finally accurately calculate the distances to things in the universe. And so every single distance measurement we now make in the universe is all calibrated on these nearby distant estimates using Henrietta Leavitt's law of pulsation time is proportional to brightness. So that in 1917, Shapley used this to try and estimate the size of the Milky Way. And he did this by using what we call globular clusters. These are clusters of about 100,000 stars in these big blobs that are very, very bright and very easy to spot and to see in the sky. And so because of that, they also have different types of stars in it that can help you calculate distances as well. And so he managed to estimate, using globular clusters that are also kind of insensitive to dust as well, that the Milky Way was about 100,000 light years wide.
It's 100,000 light years side to side.
And the sun was about 30,000 light years from the center, which he said was in the constellation of Sagittarius, because that was where the most globular clusters were found. Now that was much larger than people first thought because of the largest distance to a star seen, at least in the sun's neighbourhood, but that was because they hadn't took into account the fact that when you look to the centre, it's a lot dustier. And so for the first time we had a map of the Milky Way that put the sun not in the centre. In the same year though, Curtis was observing the Andromeda Nebula, as it was known back then, the things that were thought to be part of the Milky Way. And in it, he observed this brief brightening of a point source in it, which he said was a nova. Now, not a supernova like when you have a star that explodes and dies, but a nova's a little bit fainter than that. It's kind of a brief brightening of a new star. And so he said that nova was 10 times fainter than anything we'd seen in the Milky Way before. So if you use that to calculate the distance to Andromeda, you get something like 500,000 light years. Now that's much bigger than the estimate that Shapley had just made of the Milky Way being about 100,000 light years across. And so this triggered the great debate at the beginning of the 1920s. You had Shapley on one side arguing that the nebula were part of the Milky Way and the Milky Way was all there was in the universe. And then Curtis on the other side that was saying, actually, spiral nebula like Andromeda were actually galaxies in their own right, and the universe was much bigger than we had ever imagined. Now, the debate was eventually settled in 1926 by Edwin Hubble, who showed, using Leavitt's law, using the Cepheid variables, that the distances to Andromeda and other spiral nebulae in the sky were much larger than the size of the Milky Way, hundreds of thousands, if not millions of light years away. Now, Shapley originally called Hubble's result junk science until Hubble sent him a letter with all of his observations written down in it, and Shapley apparently responded with, "Here is the letter that has destroyed my universe." So through the 1930s, Hubble's categorizing all these brand new shapes of galaxies that we're seeing, including a lot of spiral galaxies. Combine that with the fact that in 1930, Trumpler studied open star clusters, slightly different to the globular star clusters in that they're a little bit smaller, but still under the same principles that they're not as sensitive to dust. And he used that to actually categorize what effect dust has on starlight. And so with that, we were able to start making much more accurate maps of the Milky Way for the first time. And therefore the idea that the Milky Way might actually be a spiral in the same that we'd seen in other galaxies outside the Milky Way started to take hold. So in 1940, Jan Orr was studying the persistent hiss that was present on every single radio signal sent on Earth. And he realized that that hiss or signal was coming from space. And in particular, from the constellation of Sagittarius, where the center of the galaxy was thought to be. So he then passed that observation on to Hendrik van der Hulst, who then predicted that hydrogen, again, the most abundant element in the universe and therefore pervading the majority of the Milky Way, could actually produce radiation with a wavelength about 21 centimeters, the microwave radio regime, where they'd been picking up this hiss, because of two very closely spaced electron energy levels in the atom. Now that's fantastic because, as I said, hydrogen is incredibly abundant, but also radio signals aren't sensitive to dust, so you can use them to see through the dust for the first time. So by 1951, this emission at 21 centimeters from hydrogen in the sky had actually been detected for the first time by Ewan and Purcell. Again, strongest in the direction of Sagittarius, but what it allowed was for Christian and Hindman in 1952 to actually map the motion of this hydrogen gas in the Milky Way for the first time, revealing the spiral structure and also that the Milky Way probably had a bar structure as well in the very center. So once you had that map of spiral arms in the gas, you then knew where to look for the spiral structure in the stars. And so Morgan in 1953 managed to find evidence of a spiral structure in the positions of stars in the Milky Way as well. So now the spiral structure had been confirmed, work in the 60s turned towards that more interesting result that suggested that the Milky Way could have one of these bar structures. So there's a lot of work by people like de Vaucouleurs, Peters and Hammersley all investigating this bar, especially if they could find the stars in the bar as well. And so there was a lot of debate about where that bar was, how long the bar is as well, which actually kind of still continues to this day. So because of this, through the 1970s, people were still looking for a way to see the stars behind all of this interstellar dust. Yes, they'd use the hydrogen emission and the radio to see the gas structure behind the dust, but really what they wanted to see was the stars. Now, ideally, you'd do that with infrared light. Infrared light is not affected by dust, but unfortunately, it's also absorbed by the Earth's atmosphere, so you can't use a telescope from the ground to do that. Now, Georgeland in 1976, so they came up with the next best thing. They were going to use the hot, young OB stars that were incredibly, incredibly bright, the brightest stars we knew of, especially bright in blue and UV wavelengths, to trace the spiral structure. Because they weren't as sensitive to dust as the cooler, redder stars were. And so using that, they were able to find evidence for four spiral arms in the Milky Way. The Perseus arm, the Sagittarius Carina arm, the Scutum Crux Centaurus arm, and the Norma arm. Also at the end of the 70s, Vera Rubin was studying the rotation of stars in galaxies and actually found that the speed of their rotation couldn't be accounted for how much stuff you could see in galaxies. And actually there had to be this huge extended halo of matter that we couldn't see. And so this was the first evidence for dark matter, that galaxies are embedded in these dark matter halos. And the same should also hold true for the Milky Way. Now that's a completely other story about dark matter, but if you are interested in dark matter, I devote a whole chapter to it in my new book that's coming out in September, but you can pre-order it now, and the link is in the description box below. So shameless book promotion aside, what this meant was that through the 1980s and the 1990s, a lot of the focus shifted towards measuring the total mass of the Milky Way, and whether that mass could be accounted for by the amount of stars that we could see. In 1994, Hubble Space Telescope observations by Bakel and collaborators showed that faint stars were nowhere near enough to make up the amount of matter we needed to explain the mass calculated by Zeritsky and collaborators in 1989 of 1.3 trillion times the mass of the Sun of matter in the Milky Way. So into the 2000s, we finally managed to launch an infrared space telescope so that we could see past the dust for the first time. And it meant that in 2005, the first conclusive proof that the entire Milky Way was a spiral galaxy finally came through. And that came from Benjamin and collaborators, who by looking at 30 million stars in the infrared, managed to show that the Milky Way had three arms and confirmed the fact that the Milky Way had that bar structure again. So through the rest of that decade and into the 2010s, the number of spiral arms in the Milky Way was heavily debated because there was lots of different conflicting results, some showing the Milky Way had 2, 3, and up to 4 spiral arms, until eventually a lot of measurements were combined across different wavelengths from the radio and the infrared all the way through to the ultraviolet. That eventually showed that actually the young hot stars that were very sensitive to the UV were tracing 2 spiral arms, and then the older stars that were more sensitive to the infrared were tracing another 2 spiral arms, giving 4 in total. At least that's 4 main arms. Now there are a lot of branches and spurs that come off those 4 main spiral arms, very similar to what we see in the galaxy Messier 101. In fact, the Sun is thought to be on the Orion arm, which is one of these little spurs and branches. So we can't put a definitive number on how many there are in total, but it means the general structure is agreed on. There's a bar in the center, there's 4 main spiral arms, all of that is embedded in a very, very low density stellar halo where you've got very few stars scattered over a large space, and then that again is then embedded in a much larger dark matter halo as well. But this picture could very easily change as new evidence comes to light. Such is the nature of science, as we've just heard, as theories evolve and change as new results pour in. Now, as we look towards the next decade, the future of this field definitely rests with the Gaia spacecraft. Gaia is going to make what we call a six-dimensional map of the Milky Way. So you'll have the 3D positions in X, Y, and Z of a billion stars, along with the velocities in those dimensions as well. So the velocity in the X, Y, and Z direction. So that for the very first time, we'll not just be able to get a map of the positions, but also a map of the actual movements of all of those stars in the Milky Way as well. So the first of these maps is going to be released in 2022. And I, for one, am so excited to see the evolution of the Milky Way go from this static structure that we see in the night sky to having its dynamical nature revealed in all of its glory. Captine. Fog on the Tyne is all mine, all mine. Fog on the Tyne is all mine. Trumplet. Oh, his name cracks me up every time. Just because, okay, I'm going to have to explain this to American viewers, aren't I? Trump is slang in Britain for to pass wind. Oh, if only there was a Figaro in this science history as well, because it'd be like, Galileo, Galileo, Figaro. I can't get that high. Why did I even try? Hey, it rhymed. Dinner time. I'm so hungry.